Oh yeah, now we're getting somewhere. Hey, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show on a Monday morning. I'm filling in for Earl today. I'm Stu Daniels. Thank you for tuning in. And just before the break, we were talking about the economy and businesses, big businesses, conglomerates, and private equity firms taking over small businesses or just buying up restaurants like Panera and coming up with charged lemonade and getting rid of the sourdough bread that was cooked in each restaurant every morning. But there are some other things I want to get to. And before we do, let's go back to the phone lines. We have a couple people on hold. It looks like Stephen from Green Bay is on the phone. Stephen, good morning. What do you have to say today?
Good morning, Stu. This is my first time actually hearing you on the radio, and I have to tell you, you're doing a superb job. You're doing good at really laying out the facts, so me as a caller can call in and really make an educated remark to what you're saying here. With that being said, I think we really got to stop putting labels on things and putting people or groups of people into boxes, such as socialists and capitalists. First of all, I'd like to say capitalism doesn't work, and I think we have many examples of how capitalism doesn't work. You laid one out with the Panera bread. Another good example of that would be McDonald's. At one point, they were a local business in California, and two brothers started it, and then this guy who was selling shake machines named Ray Kroc bought it out eventually and turned it into this big thing that it is now, a multi-billion-dollar company. But what you don't hear about, you hear a lot about Ray Kroc when you hear about McDonald's history, but you don't hear about the McDonald's brothers that started it. And the problem that we have when a little business gets bought out by these big businesses or turns into a big business is that a small business, you know your boss, and then most of the times you know your owners. And I worked for a small business, and the nice thing about working for a small business was if there was a snowstorm and there was 20 feet of snow on the ground, my boss also lived in the same neighborhood I did, so my boss also understood that there was 20 feet of snow on the ground. But when you work for a big corporation, most of those people live in Florida and California. They don't care that there's 20 feet of snow on the ground in Wisconsin. They know that they have a slot that you were hired to fill, and they just want you to show up. They don't care how you get there. And that's the difference. Yes, you know, big businesses, sure, do they create jobs? I'm sure they create some jobs. But the quality of the jobs is important. Chances are, if you give someone a job and it's not a good job or it's not a job that they get treated well at, they're not going to stay at it. They're more likely to stay at a job where their boss knows them on a personal level and will treat them with respect and dignity, and there's that, you know, line of, you know, communication there, than some big business where your, you know, your big boss doesn't give, you know, two iotas about you.
Yeah, those are really good points. You know, are we better off with a chain like McDonald's with stores all across the country where they pay relatively low wages? Or would we be better off, excuse me, if those thousands of restaurants were each individually owned? Now, you could say, well, they're owned by franchisees, but that's not the same as if some guy's name was on the business and he owned the business and ran everything, or a family's name was on that business. That's completely different. And so would we be better off if these were each individually owned? And another thing, which is close to my heart, is what's happened to radio over the years. When I first got into radio way back in the day, radio stations were each individually owned by families or individuals, sometimes by a newspaper that's located in that city most times. But nowadays, everything's different. You know, there are a few companies that own over 1,000 radio stations or close to 1,000 radio stations, and that sets everything up for everybody else that may still be working at a company that's smaller comparatively. But then there's an endless list of industries, different types of businesses that have gone through the same thing over the years. And are we better off by having these big corporations take over, or would we be better off working for small individual companies? And let's see. By the way, Stephen, thank you for the call. Let's go to another Steve, this one from Cudahy. Steve, are you there?
Hello, how are you? I just have a couple
I'm doing
things.
Good. Yeah.
Good. So Gary's totally wrong. I can cite Jack Welch, Mitt Romney. They're venture capitalists. What they did was bought out companies, and he got both of them got a majority of stake per the individual companies they bought, and they gave the employees and other original owners pennies on the dollar. And the only reason why Gary is saying, well, gee, look at they produce jobs and all that. They create jobs. No, they don't. Like Elizabeth Warren, the senator from Massachusetts, said the people that succeed and got millions of dollars from their companies that they started up, that they started like out of their garage or whatever, along the way, they had many, 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 many people for him to get what they got. And do you think a lot of these capitalistic monopolies would trickle down the money for the people that got that person the millions of dollars? No. And the next thing is, I was just going to tell you, read the book, Race to the Bottom. I tell Gary to read that book. It's about the economic policy of capitalism in this country. I wish we had free enterprise. There's no free enterprise in this country. It's capitalism because this country is so anti-labor and consumer. And the reason that Gary is talking like that, well, gee, what's the problem? Well, he got a windfall, whatever he got. You know, so I don't know where he's talking about just capitalism equals great, because there's a lot of other countries in the world that, like in New Zealand, Australia, that every job that you do, like the McDonald's or janitorial or whatever, is a minimum between $15 to $20 an hour. I don't know the exact amount, but it's that range. And it's a vibrant middle class. Because how can you, under the capitalism, like Henry Ford said, how can my workers build the product if they can't afford to buy them?
Right.
And I'll take my answers off the air.
Yeah. Well, thank you for the call, Steve. I appreciate you calling. And yeah, I would agree with you. You know, it seems like we are working our way toward a country where a couple of big corporations own everything in each particular industry. You know, when you look at like the aviation industry, airlines, there's just a few companies that control, 80%? Of that industry. And it's like that in a lot of different industries. So yeah, I would agree with you. Thank you for the call. Hey, let's go to Milwaukee. We've got Al from Milwaukee on the line. Good morning, Al. How are you today?
What's up, my man, Stu?
My man, is this Al Holmes? Yes.
You know it. You know it. Yeah. You see, I had to educate your engineer there to put me on some wake-up music in the morning. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, some wake-up music. I hear you.
but no, in all seriousness, I've been in Milwaukee for almost 60 years, and I've watched the industry go down the tubes. But one in particular is Briggs & Stratton. They had almost a monopoly in small engines and lawnmowers, et cetera. And then they decided to move it to Mexico.
Yeah.
They were paying, on the average, with union, $18 an hour wages here. They moved the plant down to Mexico, and they had a big report in the Journal Sentinel where they were paying people $2 a day to do the same work. And they almost went bankrupt because of the quality of the product that they were producing out of Mexico was horrible. And then they started rebuilding and rebuilding the plant here in Milwaukee to the point where it's not as big, but it's still back to building a quality product again. And I've witnessed this with Louis Alice. I've witnessed it with several other major companies, Rex Nord and what have you, and A.O. Smith. Mm-hmm. All of them did the same thing. But the other part of that was automation. The minute they started trying to put in robots and all this other stuff, you're eliminating people from the jobs. So instead of helping build jobs, they're basically building robots and other automated systems to the point where they reduce the number of human involvement to the point where people are losing jobs and they can't afford to buy a house. They can't afford to maintain a car note, and they can't afford to eat. When you got people out here now working two or three jobs trying to make the same wage that they were making at one, these billionaires are not helping the economy. They're basically tearing it down. That's just an opinion from an old man.
There we go. I got an interesting story for you, Al. Now, I know that in Wisconsin, Briggs & Stratton has always been an important company. But I grew up in Ohio in the 1960s and 70s. And way out east in Ohio, and I'm sure this was the case in a lot of places around the country, when I was growing up, my friends and I all mowed grass to make extra money. We were paper boys. We delivered the paper, but we also mowed grass, and we all bought our own lawn mowers to go make money and mow the grass of our customers and our neighbors. And the only motors, the only engines on our lawnmowers we would get were Briggs & Stratton. Everybody, all of my friends in the neighborhood, we all had to have a Briggs & Stratton engine motor on our lawnmowers. And we didn't know anything about Milwaukee at the time, where these engines were from. All we knew that the best engines, small engines, were Briggs & Stratton. So, Al, thanks for the call. I appreciate it. It's always great to hear from you. Got to take a break. Everybody stick around. You are tuned in to the Earl Ingram Show on Civic Media. A classic, Sooner or Later. Who's that, the Grassroots or something? Man, that's an oldie but a goodie. Hey, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. I'm Stu Daniels, filling in for Earl today and tomorrow. He'll be back on Wednesday. We've been discussing several different topics. The next thing I want to get to here is a new survey, a new poll. And, you know, polls, I don't put a whole lot of faith in the polls, but it's interesting to watch them and see how trends develop and change over the course of time. And one thing we've been hearing quite a bit is the fact that some of the what have been considered Democratic voters, people who vote for Democrats traditionally over the years, may be looking elsewhere. Well, that may be true just about any election cycle until we get down to actually having to vote and actually having to choose between two candidates. And in the most recent polls, it does look like people may be coming back home, as they say. And some of these voting groups, Hispanic voters, Black voters, young voters, we've heard over the past several months that they may be moving away from the Democrats. They may be moving away from Joe Biden. excuse me. But now, in the most recent polls, it looks like they may be heading back to the Democrats and back to Joe Biden. This story here from The Hill, thehill.com, just posted today, this morning, says Biden tops Trump by 4 points in new survey of young voters. Okay, I'll give you a little bit of this just so you get a feel of what this particular poll says. President Biden is narrowly leading former President Trump by 4 points in a new survey of young voters, a key demographic Biden carried in 2020. And by the way, let me ask you this. What do you think young voters see in Donald Trump? If you have an idea, if you have a response, feel free to call in 844-967-2789. I'd like to hear your answer. Back to the story in The Hill, it says the new Axios poll or Axios Generation Lab survey of 18 to 34-year-old voters found that 52% of respondents would vote for Biden if the election was held today, while 48% would back Trump. The survey noted that 70% of respondents said they were definitely planning or likely going to vote, while 30% said they were unlikely or not planning on voting. This comes as numerous polls show a close race between Biden and Trump among young voters who overwhelmingly backed Biden in 2020. Axios noted that a Pew Research Center analysis found Gen Z and millennial voters strongly supported Biden over Trump in 2020 by a margin of 20 percentage points. And a New York Times Siena poll in December found Trump leading Biden by 6 percentage points among voters under the age of 30. Other polls have also suggested Biden could be losing ground among young voters, with an NBC News poll last November finding Trump leading Biden by 4 percentage points among voters 18 to 34. In this new survey, Axios noted that Biden's lead in the new poll increased among those who say they are definitely planning on voting, and among those, which was 42%, who say they definitely plan to vote in November. Axios said 63% of those, the ones who are definitely planning on voting, 63% of those would back Biden. Okay, what about now? Yeah, lost my mic for a second. Sorry about that. So in this new poll, they also ask young voters about how much influence they believe pop star Taylor Swift could have on the election if she chooses to endorse a candidate. The New York Times reported earlier this year that the Biden campaign was seeking her endorsement, but she has yet to speak out on the race. The survey, which was just released this morning, found that 4% of young voters would consider changing their vote if Taylor Swift endorsed Biden or Trump. Excuse me. Now, what do you think the chances are that Taylor Swift would endorse Donald Trump? When asked if they would be more likely to vote in the election if Swift told them to, 6% said they would. 6%, 6 out of 100 people. The poll was conducted February 3rd through the 14th among 1,073 18 to 34-year-olds, has a margin of error of 3 percentage points. So how do you feel about that? Is that a trend? It seems to be, based on recent, and I'm talking about just in the past couple of weeks, polls that we've seen. So, Calvin, how much time do we have to the break? 2 minutes. Can we put on some music? I got to take a drink of water. I think I'm going to get a cough drop too because I've been talking too much. Let's take a break. You're tuned in to the Earl Ingram Show on Civic Media. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show on a Monday morning. I'm filling in for Earl today. My name's Stu Daniels. Thank you for joining me. And I hope you're having a good day so far. Let me ask you this, Calvin, are you there? Do you like to go camping? Have you ever been camping? Do you go camping regularly? What's your story on camping?
So I've been camping in a tent one time. Not a fan.
One time.
Not a fan.
Not a fan. What was it about going camping one time that made you decide it wasn't your thing?
To be honest with you, I just really need air conditioning. I was way too hot.
Yeah, that can be something that would turn you off to camping. That's for sure. Inside of a tent on a hot summer night, it can get pretty hot in there, pretty warm. But there is good news. I have some camping hacks. Okay. These are 15 proven camping hacks that you'll wish you knew sooner. And I wouldn't say I'm a camping authority or anything like that, but I've been camping many times over the years, usually in a tent, on the ground. But there are a few things in here that I hadn't really thought about before. And if you go camping, you might appreciate these. This is from Reader's Digest. And for those of you that are young, like my producer, Calvin, Reader's Digest used to be a magazine that you would buy at the store, often the grocery store, the drugstore. And it was a collection of stories, news stories, and special interest stories from other magazines, newspapers, news outlets, kind of like an aggregate, okay? So these are insider camping tips. These are things you may not be aware of, but could make your camping experience a lot better. First of all, carry some lint. Calvin, you have any idea why you would want to take a bag of lint on a camping trip?
My only guess would be maybe a fire starter.
That's exactly right, man. You are right on there. says here, carry some lint. We know you may be tempted to discard this kind of stuff as trash, but lint is very flammable. And at some point during your campout, you may find yourself without great kindling and in urgent need of starting a fire. That tangle of string and fluff hanging out at the bottom of your pocket can be a lifesaver if you discover that all your burnables are wet or have disappeared. If you can remember to plan ahead, start collecting the lint from your dryer for your camping trip, or you could invest in a fire starter. I guess they have these electric fire starters or battery-operated fire starters these days. But if you collect the lint from your dryer, put a match to it, probably have a good flame going in no time. Here's another thing, what you can do if you're a coffee drinker. Instead of trying to figure out how you're going to plug in your coffee maker and make coffee in the morning, what you can do is make your coffee like you make tea. Okay, just put it in a little bag and drop it in some hot water. It says here, lugging a French press to camp isn't always possible or desired, but morning coffee is obviously non-negotiable. Get your morning fix when cooking at camp by making a coffee bag, which takes a page out of tea prep. While you set water to a boil, lay a coffee filter on a flat surface. It says here your hand works. Add 1 to 2 tablespoons of finely ground coffee per cup of water in the center of the filter. Then fold up the coffee filter like a pouch and tie it closed with some cotton twine. Dip it into your mug of hot water and steep until your coffee tastes the way you like it. Okay, now here is one that I think is important. And I had never really thought about this before, but it's a smart thing to do. If you're sleeping in a tent, what you want to do is build up your tent pegs. You know, you tie your tent down with the pegs that go into the ground. And if you have to wake up in the middle of the night and run behind a bush, if you know what I'm saying, you could easily trip over one of those tent pegs or the line that goes to it. But what you do is just put a bunch of rocks around it. Okay, it says here, it's the middle of the night. You realize you have to use the restroom. It happens as you emerge from your tent in a sleepy haze in darkness. 10 out of 10 chance you will stumble horribly over your tent pegs on the way to the woods. No one likes a surprise toe stub, but it's even more miserable under these circumstances. Trust us. After you put up your tent, gather rocks around camp to make a little pyramid pile over each of your tent pegs, both so that you have a better chance of seeing and avoiding them in the first place, and also so that when you do inevitably run into them, you'll first disturb the rock pile and have a better chance of righting yourself rather than go immediately flying after tripping over the peg or the cord. Here's another camping hack for you. If you're going to be making s'mores or using a stick to cook anything, try using a live branch. Makes a big difference because it won't catch on fire, right? S'mores time is always the best time when you're making a camp, but if you try to use a dead stick for a s'mores stick, you're basically just adding more kindling to your campfire. Instead, head to the periphery of your campsite and find a long, thin, sturdy twig still attached to a tree. When you remove it, make sure it's green on the inside and that it didn't snap right off the tree. This is how you know it's still alive and will be less likely to burn up over the flame of your campfire, taking your marshmallow with it. And another thing you might want to do if it's a cold night, you can put some rocks near the campfire, and then, as long as they're not too hot, you can put them in your sleeping bag to warm up the sleeping bag before you get in. It says here, snuggling into an already warm sleeping bag is so much more pleasant than zipping up a chilly one, waiting for your body heat to do its thing. Instead, take a trick from the spa and try this camping hack. Find a few smooth, clean rocks around the size of your palm and put them right near your campfire in the evening. They retain heat beautifully. Once they're nice and toasty, put them into the foot of your sleeping bag about 30 minutes before you're planning to call it a night. When you're ready to climb in, your sleeping bag will be preheated and lovely. Just make sure the stones aren't screaming hot, as you don't want them to burn your bag. And to test them, you should be able to handle the rocks for 3 seconds with your bare hands. So another camping hack you want to do is pack a rake and or a broom. Okay, it may seem like an odd suggestion until you see your campsite for the night covered 12 inches deep in branches, wet leaves, and other forest debris. Add a small collapsible rake to your pack and make quick work of all that gunk, neatly and efficiently clearing your plot for a comfortable night's sleep. Another thing you could do if you're going camping is to make a light out of a headlamp and a big jug of water. It says here, you don't realize how dark it is out there until you spend your first night away from civilization. Bring some illumination to camp by filling a big plastic water jug with water. You could even use one of those 2.5 gallon jugs, and wrapping your headlamp around it with the light shining into the jug. The water will amplify the light from your headlamp beam, creating a lovely portable ambient camp light. What about bugs or some other kind of critters getting into your hiking boots? As a way to take care of that, typically you stash your dirty footwear outside of your tent, but who knows what kind of bug party is happening in your warm, dark hiking boots while you sleep. Avoid shock and horror the next morning by using your worn socks, okay, the ones you wore today and need to dry, to keep the intruders at bay. What you do is you flip the socks inside out so that the inside of the sock touches the inside of your boot, and then stretch the ankle over the boot shaft so that you've created a liner in your boot, right sides outward, sealing out the creepy crawlies and drying your socks. Okay. So another thing you can do is fill a metal mint tin with emergency essentials, say for instance, an Altoids tin. So what you do is you use that for an emergency kit. You can pack in some matches, like the big stick matches, some Band-Aids, some essential meds if you have them, small amount of gaffer's tape for taping together broken toes or other emergency needs. Other things you could put in are antibiotic ointment or a whistle. You can customize the case based on your specific camping adventure. The key is to take this everywhere, in your pocket, while you look for kindling, on your day hike, wherever you go, it goes. And this is especially important in bear country. Now, here's another camping hack that I was aware of and that I've always done. You want to lay a foundation. You don't put your tent directly on the ground. Put something under it. I use a tarp. It says here, use a tent footprint or tarp beneath your tent to add extra protection to your tent floor and make sleeping more comfortable. That additional layer between you and the ground does wonders to keep in the warmth and keep out groundwater seep. And if you've ever slept outside when there's a lot of dew on the ground, you know that if you don't put something under your tent, you wake up, then the whole tent seems wet on the inside. Everything that your sleeping bag, your pillow, everything seems really wet. But if you put a tarp under your tent, you should be doing a lot better. Another thing you want to do is bring some camp shoes, something to wear when you have to exit the tent to use the restroom, but you don't want to put on your big hiking boots. You wouldn't wear muddy shoes in your house, so don't wear muddy shoes in your tent and risk tracking in dirt and mud from the woods. Instead, keep a pair of easy slip-on camp shoes right outside the door, some kind of flip-flops or Crocs. These are the shoes that you slip into when you need to tend the fire or relieve yourself in the middle of the night. Instead of having to spend 5 minutes getting yourself in and out of your hiking shoes, keep the tent clean and your sanity intact by toting an easy slip-on. So another thing you could do is re-waterproof your tent. They recommend waterproofing your seams on your tent. Okay? Some tents come with the seams already waterproofed, but that stuff wears off over time, and all waterproofing eventually fades. Make sure you shore up those seams with a basic seam waterproofer that you easily brush on. You will understandably regret skipping this step if you encounter any unforeseen weather. Also, another tent hack from Reader's Digest. It says, slip on just for sleeping socks. Bring an extra pair of socks that you're going to use just for sleeping. It says here, imagine the fun you've had hiking and scrambling all over the park, but those hiking socks need a break. You'll be dirtier than you usually are when you sleep in a tent. Do not assume the socks you've worn all day will be comfy to wear all night. Bring a fresh, just for sleeping pair of socks and store them in your pillow so they stay clean and dry in the tent. All right, so there are some hacks for you if you're going camping this summer. Spring is almost here. This coming Friday is the 1st of March, which means the beginning of meteorological spring. Astrological spring doesn't start until March 20th. But for those of us who do enjoy camping, any warm weekend could be our first camping trip of the year. Hey, everybody, stick around. We got to take a quick break. It'll be a short one. You're tuned in to the Earl Ingram Show on Civic Media. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show on a Monday morning. Stu Daniels here filling in for Earl today, and tomorrow he'll be back on Wednesday. This is our final segment. Boy, this show went quickly. Thank you for calling in to all the people that called in today. And the last thing I want to get to here is how sleeping can affect your mood. Okay, I saw this story in the New York Times. It says here, your first step toward a better mood. Poor sleep can make anxiety, depression, and other mental health issues worse. And here is what to do about it. And it starts here. It says, it started with mild anxiety. Emily, who asked to be identified only by her first name because she was discussing her mental health, had just moved to New York City after graduate school to start a marketing job at a big law firm. She knew it was normal to feel a little on edge, but she wasn't prepared for what came next: chronic insomnia. Operating on only 3 or 4 hours of sleep, it didn't take long for her anxiety to ramp up. At 25 years of age, she was close. Excuse me, it says here, at 25, she was, quote, freaking nervous all the time, a wreck, end quote. When a lawyer at her firm yelled at her one day, she experienced the first of many panic attacks. At a doctor's suggestion, she tried taking a sleeping pill in the hopes that it might reset her sleep cycle and improve her mood. Well, it didn't work. Americans are chronically sleep deprived. 1/3 of adults in the United States say they get less than 7 hours a night. Teenagers fare even worse. About 70% of high school students don't get enough sleep on school nights. and it's having a profound effect on mental health. An analysis of 19 studies found that while sleep deprivation worsened a person's ability to think clearly or perform certain tasks, it had a greater negative effect on mood. Okay. And when the National Sleep Foundation conducted a survey in 2022, half of those who said they slept less than 7 hours each weekday also reported having depressive symptoms. Some research even indicates that addressing insomnia may help prevent postpartum depression and anxiety. Clearly, sleep is important. But despite the evidence, there continues to be a shortage of psychiatrists or other doctors trained in sleep medicine, leaving many to educate themselves. So, what happens to our mental health if we aren't getting enough sleep, and what can be done about it? When people have trouble sleeping, it changes how they experience stress and negative emotions, said Eric Prather, a sleep researcher at the University of California, San Francisco, who treats patients with insomnia. And he says, and for some time, this can have a feed-forward effect. Feeling bad, ruminating, feeling stressed can bleed into our nights, he said. Carly Demler, 40 years old, a stay-at-home mother in North Carolina, said she went to bed one night and never fell asleep. From that point onward, she would be up at least once a week until 3 or 4 a.m. It continued for more than a year. She became irritable, less patient, and far more anxious. Hormone blood work and a sleep study in a university lab offered her no answers. Even after taking Ambien, she stayed up most of the night. Quote, it was like my anxiety was a fire that somehow jumped the fence and somehow ended up expanding into my nights, she said. I just felt I had no control. In the end, it was cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia, or CBTI, that brought Ms. Demler the most relief. Studies have found that this CBTI is more effective than sleep medications are over the long term. As many as 80% of the people who try it see improvements in their sleep. Ms. Demler learned not to lay in bed and freak out. Instead, she gets up and reads so as not to associate her bedroom with anxiety. Then she returns to bed when she's tired. Here's a quote. She says, the feeling of gratitude that I have every morning when I wake up and feel well rested, I don't think will ever go away. That's been an unexpected silver lining. And as you probably know, adults need between 7 and 9 hours of sleep a night. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, teenagers and young children need even more. But it's not just about quantity. The quality of your sleep is also important. If it takes more than 30 minutes to fall asleep, for example, or if you regularly wake up in the middle of the night, it is harder to feel rested, regardless of the number of hours you spend in bed. But some people have a tendency to think they're functioning well, even if they're sleepy during the day or having a harder time focusing, said Lynn Bufka, a clinical psychologist and spokeswoman for the American Psychological Association. So ask yourself, how do you feel during the day? You find that you're more impatient or quick to anger? Are you having more negative thoughts, or do you feel more anxious or depressed? You find it harder to cope with stress? You find it difficult to do your work efficiently? If so, it's time to take some action. So what you can do, we've all heard how important it is to practice good sleep hygiene, employing the daily habits that promote healthy sleep. And it's important to speak with your doctor in order to rule out any physical problems that need to be addressed, like a thyroid disorder or restless legs syndrome. But there are things you can do. Obviously, one of the most important things is to turn everything off before you get in bed. Turn off the television, turn off all the lights, make it quiet in your space, and also cooler temperatures help as well. And if you want to check out more on that, that's a story from the New York Times. Man, we've run out of time already. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Thanks to all the callers who called in. I'll be back tomorrow filling in for Earl on the Earl Ingram Show. Everybody have a great day. Do something nice for someone today. And thanks to Calvin for helping out. When you get home, break it on, lose that number. Break it on.